The Connolly Association dominated Irish politics, emigrant politics. The Connolly Association was basically a manipulative group pretending to be Fianna Fáil nationalists in the interests of Russia, because had not joined the NATO and all the rest of
it. I know.
And there was a little milieu around the CP. There's some documents about them in the CP files at the Manchester Labour Movement archives. And some of the people in the Connolly Association, in the Communist Party, objected to the Connolly Association, most notably Brian Behan.
Yeah.
Now, Behan was very young. He was elected to the executive of the CP in 51. He would have been about 21, 22.
Yeah.
And he was a great agitator. And he didn't see any sense at all in the Connolly Association pretending to be nationalist. He wanted to make socialist propaganda.
And yes, so did others. Just a moment. I did once go through the files, when I was much younger, of some of the papers of Irish Freedom, and I became Irish Democrat. I got the impression that in the late 40s, it was more socialistically attuned than it became under later on. Possibly that was was it Diggs who was the editor?
No, I think in the 40s during the war, it was Pat Dooley.
Oh.
Pat Dooley was English, Irish extraction. He eventually went off to East Europe as a Stalinist functionary.
Yeah.
And he came back about 53, 54, utterly disillusioned with Stalinism. You know?
Yeah,
and
he was the sculptor, wasn't he?
Don't know.
There was a Dooley who was, I think he was in Liverpool or somewhere, and I knew about him. He produced, he was avant-garde sculptor anyway.
What do you call him? Look, the point about it is there was this Irish milieu. And after the Hungarian Revolution was suppressed, a lot of them, including Behan, gravitated towards the Trotskyists. And the Trotskyist group was the Gerry-Healyites. And then they very quickly left or were expelled from the Gerry-Healy organisation. Behan, for example, was expelled in early 1960. And then some of these people, Behan, they formed an organisation to rival the Connolly Association, the Irish Workers' Union, at the end of 59. And one of their rules was they wouldn't have fascists in membership or Stalinists. And they were dominated politically by a guy called Michael Callanan. Now, Michael Callanan had been in Australia. He said he was a syndicalist, but he had been involved in politics too. He wasn't an anti-political syndicalist. Now, I got to know him very slightly later on. But, I mean, inside the group, and I don't know what happened exactly, but various political disputes developed. Again, I don't know the facts. And eventually, anyway, a quasi-Trotsky's group dominated. They had a paper called The Irish Worker. Was it called The Irish Worker? I think it was, yes. But I've only seen a couple of copies. I've never seen a file. But the copies I've seen were edited by Dalton. And Dalton, at that stage of the paper, was simply Mandela International. They were simply orthodox Trotskyists. And then, for some reason, they collapsed. And this was the time the Maoists were developing. Russia and China had been in dispute from the late 50s. By 63, the first Maoist group in Britain came out of the Communist Party. And they formed a quite big newspaper called Vanguard. And they were led by Michael McCreary, who was the son of a general.
Yes, I saw some of their propaganda.
Michael McCreary, he died of leukemia in 65 probably.
Yeah.
Now, he was a very, very bourgeois man. You know, he talked to you and take, here's my card. You know, very, very bourgeois. But he died. And when he died, the thing fragmented. And before he died, however, they wanted to set up an Irish group, an Irish emigrant group. And again, I'm not sure of some of the details, but an Irish group was founded by the Maoists, then joined by the Trotskyists.
But by
Irish Maoists who were not pro McCreary or McCreary pro them. And thus they formed the Irish Communist Group.
I think it was 64.
And I mean, there was, I can remember the first issue of the paper I saw at the Militant Office in 65, I guess. Mm-hmm. And its impression on me was that I couldn't make out what they were. They were obviously revolutionaries. They hark back to a sort of Stalinist or communist past. But again, they weren't obviously Maoists. But of course, the Maoists only became what we know as Maoist crazies after the Cultural Revolution in 66. Mm-hmm. A lot of CPers who were disillusioned with the reformism of the Communist mm-hmm. Party, who traced the reformism back to the break with Stalin and so on, mm-hmm. and thus followed the Chinese, they were reasonable people, a lot of them. You know, and I mean, they used to gravitate around King's Cross because the Connolly Association office was in Gray's Inn Road.
I know, Gray's Inn, I've been there.
And when I first encountered them, I was quite impressed by them. You know, they seemed thinking people. They weren't dogmatic, or didn't seem to be. And I thought they were people who could be won, but of course they wouldn't.
No, I know, there was this, you know, you could talk with them and then the eyes glazed over, so to speak, and they started saying, you know, long live Chair. Well, they didn't actually. The almost native ones in Ireland were loonier, were bonkers, more madder. I mean, you know, but the BICO or the ICO as they then were. Well, the ICG were smoother, I agree. And of course, as I say, they were much more productive.
They were very productive.
But the point, the thing was that, you know, they were too, in the long run, they were too productive for their own good.
Yeah, but I always thought of, you know, what Lenin said about the web, Sydney and Beatrice. Mm-hmm. More industry than brains. They had a lot of industry. The point about the ICG, though, was that it involved Jerry Lawless.
Yes.
Now, at that time...
And Dalton.
Yeah, but at that time, the Trotskyists, all of us, were paying great attention to the debates, China and Russia. Mm-hmm. Because the Chinese, if you forgot who they were, what they stood for, the Chinese were saying things that were true about reformist Stalinism. Mm-hmm. And we paid a lot of attention. People wrote pamphlets to George Novak, for example. And Jerry justified his role in this to me afterwards on the grounds that he was carrying through the tactic mm-hmm. of the Mandel International. Mandel, for example, in Belgium, tried to link up with some Maoists. But they created the Irish Communist Group and began publishing a little duplicated weekly, mm-hmm. Irish Workers' News, and then a magazine.
And so
but I mean, Jerry justified being involved, but I mean, Jerry wasn't able to handle any of it politically.
No, you know? No. He did a couple of articles. I think Dalton did one too. I remember it was an unfinished article about the language anyway, which of course he was expert on.
Jerry couldn't handle it politically, and the Maoists dominated the group.
I know.
Jerry became editor of the magazine and Solace. By the way, Liam Dalton, who was a Gaelic scholar, as you know.
I know.
He told me that Unsolace, which they intended to mean something like enlightenment, literally meant something closer to the light bulb. I can't tell you that's true, but that was Liam's
comment. He may be right. He probably know anyway.
Well, I mean, the Unsolace, for example, edited by Jerry. I remember one editorial comment, which wouldn't have been Jerry, quoting Stalin. Mm-hmm. To the effect that against peaceful revolution. But the idea of taking, you know, and Jerry was involved in it. Now, Liam Dalton hadn't been involved.
No, he hadn't, and he raised the matter at a meeting, and he sort of, there's sort of two versions. One I heard from Brendan Clifford himself, but the other I heard from Jerry Lawless that, you know, that Clifford said just that Dalton blew up at this meeting and caused
crime. Well, Dalton who blew up?
Well, I'm just going what Clifford told me. And then somebody else said that, actually, they're both quotations from Clifford. Clifford gave me the personal one, Dalton blew up, and then he said in the magazine, his account of it was that Dalton gave a reason, as far as possible, a reasoned account of Trotskyism, and you know, so they were sort of...
He didn't give an account of Trotskyism. My understanding of it is Dalton, as he got back into activity, raised some points that Clifford had made in the magazine, about Stalinism and so on. But Dalton was very, very impressive, in fact.
He could be,
Dalton raised it politically, and then Gerry started effing and blinding, and Gerry blew up. And if that's how it happened, Gerry was simply...
Well, Gerry admitted subsequently that Dalton gave a long spiel about, the treachery of... treachery of Stalinism around the world, which he was quite an authority. Yeah. And then Gerry came in and started needling the
apparently he started effing and blinding.
If he effed and blind, but he probably did do a bit of it, but it was sort of... he did manage to get under the skin and provoke split in the Irish Communist group.
Liam provoked the split politically, but what happened with Gerry at that meeting was after he threw his tantrum and effing and blinding, he was removed as editor of the magazine.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it just so happened that I was in King's Cross at the time. I was on holiday and I was going through the archives of the RSL Grants.
Mm.
Grant and I left the little office and were walking up towards King's Cross, and Gerry came along the pavement and he was very, very humble. Gerry could do humble or cock of the walk easily. And he was humble, very humble. Ted, we want your help. And then Liam produced a document with the help of Grant. Liam said it was Grant's document, but Liam was very modest.
Arthur Dean, wasn't he? Arthur Dean was another guy.
Was a leading member of the. He was one of the secretariat that ran the group.
Of the management.
All I know is what I saw, and it was there. Gerry came along. Now I'd met Gerry. The first time I met Gerry was at a social. It would have been about 2 or 3 months earlier. And I'd been told he had been a Trotskyist, but was no longer a Trotskyist, which was a reasonable construction of what he was doing. So I talked to him and said, I hear you used to be a Trotskyist. And he looked at me. Who put the used to be on it? And then he stalked away with his head up in the air like a righteous man. That was my first meeting. The second meeting, he was very humble with Ted. And the fundamental point, though, is that it was a political dispute, obviously. It was a dispute about the whole history of communism.
Yeah. Well, very obviously. I mean, it was a real sort of thing.
But I mean, it was a very small group.
Yeah, yeah.
And what happened was that Gerry dominated people like Dalton and what you call him? Phil Flynn, right. And eventually they forced an organisation split without any political clarification. Gerry boasted to me that he knew his tactics, and what he did was he didn't present Dalton Grant document for voting on, for or against it. He presented it as a reason why the group should not be Maoist, which the Maoists were now pushing to make it far more openly Maoist. And basically, the Irish Working Group was the result, and it was a complete menagerie politically, you know? And in the first phase, it was influenced very heavily by the Cork Republican Jim Lane and Company.
Was it really that much influenced? I mean, I know that Lane was in touch.
No, Jerry used to send me their magazine monthly, their magazine. Jerry was influenced by them. But fundamentally, Jerry's agitation was against the turn to politics, not just to the specific Stalinist politics.
Maybe, yeah.
But no, you look at the file, you see it. I mean, the thing that I eventually did something about was that the front page full article in Irish Militant and a picture. And it's a picture of IRA trainees breaking down their guns in the dark.
Yeah.
And a caption saying something like, if certain people have their way, this will be a scene of the past. Now, actually, the IRA in the dark was a perfect metaphor for the whole IRA enterprise.
Yeah, yeah, there was that.
They sided with the the reaction to the politicisation. And
well, he said he said he was, of course, in touch with these people, and he maintained that they were sort of, in fact, a bit more political than that. I remember he described this guy, Frank Driver of, I think it is it, Baltinglass, County Kildare. He's he is, you know, he that time that, you know, he was broken with it and described himself again. Sort of inopportunely, presumably, but still more politically than that, as than simply physical force, as a Guevarist. Possibly he didn't know, he never read Guevara or something. I don't know Frank, I never knew Frank Driver, but he was a prominent Republican. Who
I left, never knew him either.
But he was probably Republican of the left. I mean, there were, you know, it was... There you are putting ideas... up Egypt Road, and then there was all this mass, from which gradually people pulled themselves out, and sometimes found themselves on the wrong side of the stream or the marsh or whatever, and to see it in quite as clear terms as we would like to. Is probably a mistake that we're dealing with a lot of people who are very confused.
Indeed.
And that is the problem.